Welcome back. This is Face the Nation. I start off the final round with Sonali Walingabadugay, who is an attorney at law. Sonali, what action can we take? The media, the business community, the government, what action must we take and should take to end this problem?
So modern day slavery refers to a situation where freedom is taken away mm-hmm. by threat, violence, coercion, abuse of power and deception. So in most situations, the bargaining power of the employee mm-hmm. is very less. Also, we spoke consistently about the lack of knowledge and skills of these employees, as a result of which they get embroiled in modern day slavery. So in order for this situation to be resolved, at least to a certain extent, we require a multi-stakeholder approach. The Capital Maharaja organization, as one of the largest privately owned conglomerates, employs thousands of employees. There are procedures in place. There are regulations. So similarly, there are other corporates in Sri Lanka which ensure that employee rights are protected and upheld. So that is the business sector. Then what about smaller businesses? Who is going to monitor them? There are law enforcement authorities. There is a legal framework. However, the implementation mechanisms need to be strengthened further. The government then has to, as I once before said, care enough. I remember Shamir long, about 5-6 years ago, I'm not really sure, when the UK had an outbreak of mad cow disease, a politician, just to say that, prove to the people of the country that they had got rid of the disease, he fed a piece of beef to his little daughter. Now, I feel that unless one of our politicians has the will to say, okay, fine, I will send my daughter as a worker, as a domestic worker or as a migrant worker to the Middle East or wherever, right? Why doesn't that confidence spring? Because they know they are not affected by it. So similarly, we come back to the argument of the government, the major stakeholder in this enterprise, not caring enough. Moving forward, what we need to do is similar to what was discussed in the Bali process. These now need to be made actionable. The relevant stakeholders need to be gathered together. They need to converge and come up with actionable plans to implement across the board, not just at state level, but also district level, provincial level, so that there is a greater dissemination of information about rights, about entitlements, and about responsibilities.
Right. Thank you very much, Sonali. I think you were referring to the May 16th, 2015 incident where John Gummer fed daughter a burger to disapprove the belief of mad cow disease that was spreading in the UK at that time. But I also want to recollect a bit of more information to you. That was in the year 2007, October 12th. There was an incident in which a similar incident that took place, and the daughter died of the human form of mad cow disease after this particular burger was a piece of meat that was fed. So just to bring that to light to you as well. So let's now move to Dr. Bilesha Veeratna, Research Fellow, Institute of Policy Studies. Bilesha, quite interestingly, now we are talking about the need for the business community, the government and everyone to unite to ensure that we are on the right track in terms of modern day slavery. But what are the challenges Sri Lanka faces in terms of getting access to labor opportunities overseas? Do we really have challenges, or
yes,
don't we have any challenge?
We have a lot of challenges. One is that we don't know, we don't have a good idea about the opportunities available over there. A lot more can be done by our embassies overseas to explore the exact opportunities available and do a right mapping with the labor supply in the country and prepare our workforce towards opportunities available overseas.
Where do we really stand as a country, as a nation, in terms of moving ahead? We saw a dip of foreign remittances in the year 2015. Would that happen again in the future? If so, are we really geared up to take on the country's economy to the next step?
I don't think another dip would happen because right now it's the growth path is almost as it was before. And the slow picking up of skilled persons and the high volume of mail migration kind of compensates for the loss that has taken place. So things hopefully would move in the right direction.
What is the message you have for the government, Dr. Bileshwar? Do you think that there needs to be more done?
Yes, one thing that we could do is right now the training, the timing of the training is not all that ideal. The pre-departure training happens after the migrant worker has made the decision to migrate. So after one has made the decision to migrate, no matter what you're going to say, it's not going to sink in because they just have made up their mind to go. So the awareness has to be given well before the decision has been made so that they can make a very calculated, educated decision.
Thank you very much, Dr. Bileshwar Veerarathna, Research Fellow, Institute of Policy Studies. I now move my attention to Mangala Randhaniya, Deputy General Manager Training, Sri Lanka Bureau of Foreign Employment. What is the message, Mr. Randhaniya, you have for the embassies in the Middle East in terms of ensuring that Sri Lankans who are working in their respective countries are safe? What is the message you have?
Yeah, for the embassy, of course, we are always telling the embassy officials and the especially the officials deployed by the bureau to the labor section to attend to the matters coming from the worker and referring from the Bureau of Foreign Employment without delaying. Attending to the matter and taking that matters with the authorities at the destination countries and trying all the efforts to reduce those issues as early as possible. That is for the population at the moment working. But the embassy labor section is the key point where job opportunities being attested and sent to the Bureau of Foreign Employment for the approvals. At that point, there is an ample opportunity for embassy officials to check the credibility of the workplace and to get the correct decision in terms of whether this particular workplace to be approved or not to be approved. So that's up to the embassy officials deployed by us, and we are always explaining to them, approve only the credible workplaces or the possible and right insured workplaces. So that responsibility is with the labor section officials. If that officials do well in approving the workplaces before it comes to the Sri Lanka, so that then we will have right insured workplaces for Sri Lankan workers leaving the country. So
thank you very much,
that's the message that what
thank
I can
you very
say.
Much, Mangala Randhaniya, Deputy General Manager Training, Sri Lanka Bureau of Foreign Employment. Our final speaker this evening is Swari Rupa Singha, National Program Officer on Labour Migration, ILO. We spoke about the message to the business community, we spoke about the message to the government in terms of the country's economy, we spoke about the messages to the embassies in question, but we should not forget those migrant workers who are going overseas and who are seeking employment. What is the message the ILO has for
them? I think the message is to learn as much as information as you can, keep your family members informed. Also, when seeking employment, learn a little bit more about your recruitment agent, his status of registration, whether it's renewed annually. Seek information from local officers, seek information from the Foreign Employment Bureau based at the district level, and also talk to returned migrants in your community, in your neighborhood. I think they can share a lot of experiences which others can take note of and be use as safeguards.
Thank you very much, Swari Rupa Singh, a National Program Officer on Labour Migration, representing the International Labour Organization. Before I thank the four of you and my two fellow journalists, I thought I'll say that never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it is the only thing that ever has. So thank you very much, Swari Rupa Singh, Research Fellow, Institute of Policy Studies. Thank you very much, Mangala Randhania, who is the Deputy General Manager, Training, Sri Lanka Bureau of Foreign Employment. Thank you very much, Dr. Bilesha Veeratna, Research Fellow, Institute of Policy Studies. Nice to have you on board today. And also, my colleague and a friend, Sonali Vanagabadugir, Manager Corporate Affairs, News First, the Capital Maharaja Organization Limited. It was nice to hear from the four of you today. Thank you very much, Nadim, and thank you very much, Charita, for joining us this evening. I must say, Charita, it's no easy task to get these four people today on the show. Thank you very much for arranging and coordinating these efforts as well. Thank you very much for watching us tonight. Remember, the only message that we heard and we gathered from these four three ladies and one gentleman is the fact that modern-day slavery exists, and Sri Lankans are also at the receiving end of all this and more. Educate yourself. Remember that what Swairu said in her closing remarks. Speak to your fellow countrymen. Speak to those who have returned from these countries and understand what laws govern these countries before even stepping into these countries in question. Remember, it may look like the heaven, sometimes it is not. I leave you tonight with a quote, as I always do. You may choose to look the other way, but you can never say again that you did not know. Every one of you have a responsibility. Thank you. Take care and good night.